My name is Stanislaw Robert Luberda, and this is lesson 10 of 10 in my free Adobe Premiere Pro introductory course. In this lesson, we're going to be talking about exporting different kinds of media files and some things that you should be aware of when you're exporting your media. Let's go ahead and start exporting. Say we've completed our project here, and this is that same project that we've been working with since the beginning here. And if you want the media, you can find this in my lesson 5 Basics of Editing course. If I want to just get this out, this is all complete, I'm going to come up to File, Export, and you'll notice I have some different options here. Let's briefly talk about some of these different exports. If we are working with multiple files, we could do a batch list export. If we're exporting a specific title, which we looked at in our lesson 9 class, titles, that's where I can do this here. If you're on 2013 or above, you should be able to export our caption. Captions are not covered in this course as it is a little bit more of an advanced workflow. Tape, DV, and serial device are basically exactly what that sounds like. It is recording onto a tape-based device, whether it is a DV, HDV, so maybe like a Canon GL1 or a GL2, some of the serial devices, maybe a separate DEC. But the options that we do have here are EDL, OMF, AAF, and Final Cut Pro XML. These all work the same way, and what these are basically edit decision lists. So you can see here, as soon as I clicked on that, it's gonna ask me what I wanna call it, where I wanna start this time code. I'm just gonna hit okay for right now so we can take a look at this. And I'm gonna place this into my lesson 10 exports, and let's review exactly what that is. As an example here, you can see it has our title, and if it's in drop frame or non-drop frame, and which clips are playing at what time, how loud it is, how long the duration is, etc. So this is extremely useful if I'm working between different editing programs. So if I'm working with Avid or Sony Vegas or DaVinci Resolve, it's extremely useful to be able to get out this information and be able to import the same media in a different editing program and continue working with it. There's one caveat in here. This Final Cut Pro XML does not work very well at all in Final Cut Pro 10. If you are using Final Cut Pro 7 or Final Cut Pro Classic, this will work for you. When you are exporting those different EDLs or edit decision lists, it's not going to be able to support things that aren't supported in other programs. For example, this adjustment layer isn't in Sony Vegas as far as I know, so this is going to come up as something that it is unknown. Any of your titles will be unknown. Any video effects that may be in here that aren't common effects will not be translated as well. So be aware of that if you are ever working with another editing suite. For our purposes here, we just want to export our video here. And so I'm going to go to File, Export, Media, or in my case, Command M. And when we click on that, we're brought to an export window. A lot of people tend to get a little confused when they're looking at this export window. If you've ever worked with Photoshop before and you have your Save for Web, this is actually pretty similar. On our left side here, we have a preview of our video. So if I can scroll through down here and review how my video is going to look. Notice it tells me the total duration, which is right here, 59 seconds and 3 frames. Now let's come back up here to the top on our export settings. We have a few different formats and presets. This lesson isn't going to go into all the minute details of these different formats and presets. If you're looking for more information on formats and presets, I definitely recommend checking out my Adobe Media Encoder video. It is fairly comprehensive and talks about lots of different things, and we're just going to take a brief overview of this today. In this main window is really what we care about here. This is our source, or this is what it's starting out as when it's in our sequence. So it is a 1920 by 1080, 30 frames per second progressive at 59 seconds and 3 frames, 44.1 hertz sound. Our output here is telling me that it's going to change it into an MP4 codec because I'm in an H.264 format. It is a one-pass VBR with a target bit rate of 10 megabytes. And a max bit rate of 12 megabytes per second. All that is listed down here. So all of this is a summary of everything that we have in here. So if I change my format right now to, let's say, QuickTime, this is something that I'll usually be using. And I'm going to go to QuickTime. And you'll notice that I don't really have a lot of things that I want to work with. There's all these different ones here. I've got a few down here that I've created. And this will definitely change my output. And I can view that output right here. So if I change this right now to 1920 by 1080, I can still see that I have these pillar bars here. This is actually going to export the way it is right now. So why is it doing this? Well, if I come down here to my aspect ratio, I can see that this is at 9091. I'm going to want to change that to 1. And now you can see that it is completely filling my frame. Just to illustrate that again, I'm going to go back down to this NTSC 50 here. And you'll notice what's happening is I have like these great big letterboxes, and that's not necessarily what I want. And the reason for that is because this is in a 4/3 aspect ratio, where my master output is actually in a 16:9. So to fit that, it has to scale it a certain way, because we're still fitting all these pixels in here. For our purposes right now, more often than not, this is the format that you're going to want. You're going to want an H.264, and we're going to hit match source, high bit rate. And for the most part, that's going to take care of lots of different things. Depending on the settings that you change, like say, for example, our target bit rate, our maximum bit rate, and our bit rate encoding, that will change our estimated file size. So if I change this to, let's say, a 5 and an 8, you'll notice that that changed my file size to 37 megabytes. This is an estimate that is fairly loose depending on exactly what's happening. And what we're telling Premiere right now is to give it less information on its export. So this is typically not going to be as clear or have as much information as needed to encode it properly. We're constantly trading off quality versus size. So typically the bigger the video is, it tends to have more information, which could make it look more clearer. I have lots of people that ask me, what's the best codec to use? What do I want to use to get my file sizes super small? And there's no such thing as a perfect answer. It always depends on what's happening in your scene. If this was an interview with someone just talking, I'll probably want to put my maximum bitrate and my target bitrate fairly low. If there's a lot of motion that's happening in my scene, I'm going to want to raise up that maximum bitrate. I may also want to change this to a constant bitrate. So if you ever hear someone say this is the perfect codec to put everything out at, always use this. It's always going to be different. However, for the most part, this is usually the setup that I recommend for a lot of people, especially when they're first getting started. The only thing I really want you to be aware of is make sure you don't have any black bars, because that will export when you're exporting. Also, be sure to review your height and width settings. Notice right now, I can't change that setting because that is built in to H.264. at the high bitrate match source. So it is matching my original source. I can uncheck this and change this if I want to, say, 978 by 1080, and you can see that that's scaled it quite a bit because of my aspect ratio. Moving down here, I'm just gonna skip across the rest of these. I'm not gonna get into the audio or the multiplexer or the captions, but what I do wanna talk about is right down here. We have our use previews, import into project, and queue and export. What using previews will do is, if you remember, every time that we were hitting enter to render out our scene in the background, that was creating previews. So by using this button, we'll speed up a lot of our renders if it doesn't have to do anything else, if it doesn't have to rescale it. Import project will export it and bring it right back into our project, so you have a completed video inside of your project. And down here we have queue and export. If we hit export, that will lock up Premiere. We won't be able to do anything else with it because Premiere will put all its energy into exporting out this timeline. If we hit queue, this will send it to the Adobe Media Encoder, where we have lots more options. So the very last thing I'm going to do is just double check, make sure that everything is correct. Click on my output file name And we're going to place this into our lesson 10. And I'm just going to say lesson 10 export 1080 so I know what it is. And I'm going to hit export. Again, now that it is exporting, there's nothing I can do in here, and it gives me a time remaining. Depending on the speed of your computer's processor, and or if you're using graphics acceleration, like with a GPU that we picked from our very first and second lesson in our project settings, this number may or may not go very quickly. More so than ever, GPUs are used a lot for rendering out video projects. They can immensely speed up our projects. So if you're wondering why this is always going very slowly, chances are you may not have a supported graphics processing unit. I'm gonna go ahead and cancel this for right now, and I'll just show you what happens when we click on queue. If I click on queue, this actually opens up a completely separate program, and that's gonna be the Adobe Media Encoder. It looks like this guy right down here. So now that that's opened up, mine's gonna look a little bit different than in older versions. This is a new version of the Adobe Media Encoder. We have my lesson 10 exports. It's in its specific format and preset and the name of it. And I can go ahead and start my item. When I start it here, you'll notice that it's rendering in the background. Again, what's useful about this is it may go a little bit slower, but I can continue working on my project while that's working in the background. Now you'll probably have extra questions, and there's probably lots of things that you've run into that you know you may want some more information on, and I ask you that you can visit my website, www.stanislawrobertliberta.com. I do offer face-to-face and classroom-based training. I am located in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. However, if you need to, you can definitely fly me out for you and your team, and I'd be happy to work with you. Feel free to comment and subscribe on my videos, and I'll do my best to answer your questions. So that's it. You've completed all 10 lessons of the Adobe Premiere Pro introductory training. You should have enough information to get you up and running and start creating some of your projects. Again, my name is Stanislaw Robert Luberda with AV Ultra. Hopefully you found this useful.